Thank you, Susan and Jamie. It's beautiful. Welcome, everyone. Good to have you here. It's nice to have some sunshine this morning. Makes the world look a lot better. If you're visiting with us, I don't know that I see any visitors, but if you were given a card, we'd ask that you might fill that out and give it to someone before you leave. The prayer list, call your attention to the prayer list. There have been some additions. There's been some taken off through answered prayer. So we'd ask that you might remember those people. Birthdays and anniversaries. Today we've got an anniversary, don't we, Doug?
Yeah, we do. If we make it to 3 o'clock today.
3 o'clock. Yeah. And how many?
40.
Wow. Congratulations. That's good. That's the only anniversary we have. We haven't had anniversaries for a while. We have some birthdays. Today, Chris and I share a day together. Happy birthday, Chris. Now, on the 14th, it's Isabella Blackwood and Lucille Cutshaw. On the 16th, Jill Vesta and Aiden Webb. And on the 17th, Amanda Blackwood. And Doug, you have an announcement?
So we need to have a deacons meeting after church in the junior high classroom, or juniors classroom down the hall. And last week I spoke for a sermon, and I knew there were some things I was forgetting, and Irene and Olivia were very good sports for coming up here. So my verses were, which went along with what Irene said, that she didn't trust in me, but she trusted in the Lord, with Psalms 118:8. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. And Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. When I got done last week, I was kind of stressed, and all of a sudden my mind went blank, and I said, well, I'm done, and walked off, and never thought about prayer. I was just glad my sermon was over. So I kind of apologize for that, but it's the way it is. And even Irene gave me gave the Bible verse again. So thank you.
Thank you, Doug. Activities coming up this week. Monday at 7 o'clock, trustees are meeting. And Wednesday, 9:30 is ladies' prayer, 3:45 Circle J, and 6 o'clock is choir. Friday from 12 to 1 is the ladies' fellowship. Again, we need volunteers for nursery and children's worship. You can sign up on the bulletin board outside the office. And then looking ahead a little bit, next Sunday we'll have our Christmas cantata. Choir's been working really hard on it. They're really a dedicated bunch. We're fortunate to have people like that who will devote their time and their talents to putting this on. And then at 6 o'clock next Sunday, we'll go Christmas caroling. And then on Saturday, December 24th, will be Christmas Eve services beginning at 6 o'clock p.m. And then Sunday, Christmas Day, we will not be having Sunday school, but we will be having worship service beginning at 10:30. Are there any other announcements? Jamie's pretty good about laying these all out for me. Appreciate her. Let's go to our memory verse at the Sunday school youth learning, and maybe by the time we're done with this, we can all say it without the words. But it's Luke 2:14, which says, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Let's go to God in prayer. Our God and Father in heaven, we thank you that we can meet in this your house, that we can worship you, and we thank you for being our Savior. We celebrate this season where we commemorate the birth of your Son, and we hope that we carry that with us throughout the entire year. We ask that you be among us this morning, that we might feel your presence here. Guide and direct everything that's thought, said, and done this morning, that it might be pleasing in your sight. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now if you stand as you're able, we'll sing How Great Our Joy. Behind the door, you'd open up the door for the particular day, and there'd be a little thing that you're supposed to do, a little scripture or something like that, and a piece of chocolate. And she said, according to my Advent house, we only have 3 days till Christmas.
Matthew 2, 10 and 11. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
On the first Sunday of Advent, we light a candle symbolizing the hope of the world as we waited for our Messiah. First Sunday of Advent, we light a candle symbolizing the hope of the world as we wait for our Messiah. The second Sunday, a candle was lit to remind us to prepare our hearts and minds for the imminent coming of our Lord. Today, we light the pink candle to remind us of the joy we have in our hearts, knowing that Jesus came to earth because of his boundless love for man. We need to focus on joy, which should constantly be a part of our lives, knowing that our Heavenly Father loves us.
Thank you, Mary and Greg. Let's go to God in prayer. Our God and Father in heaven, we come before you again. We bow down. We worship you. We look up to you for everything we have. We thank you for providing for us. For it's you that provides the air we breathe. You that provides the food we eat. You that provides all of our needs, all of our wants, all of our desires. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for being our Savior. We ask that you be with those on our prayer list today. We know that you know the cause, what they need, and you know how to minister to them. We ask that you be with those who we don't know about, who need you. We ask that you might touch them, that you might be with them. We ask that you be with those who are traveling, that you might grant them traveling mercies. We thank you for the leadership of our country. We thank you for the leadership of our congregation. We ask that you continue to guide and direct us, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now Jeff will share some music. Thank you.
rescue me. This baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew was hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
We'll and turn to page 270. We'll sing Joy to the World. The words will be on the screen. Thank you. like to go to children's worship. And we'll invite Pastor Rob to come.
Okay, good morning. I tell you, the music this morning got me right in the feels. You know what I mean by that? It was just very heartwarming and encouraging and blessing, and I appreciate it so much. Also, you have done a beautiful job in decorating your facility for Christmas. It's just very, very nice. My apologies to Doug for last Sunday. I tried to tough it out until I think I called Danny about 9:30 at night or something like that on Saturday, and it's like, I'm just not gonna make it. And I didn't. But I'm glad Doug did that, and appreciate him so much. Everybody got all of their Christmas preparations done at your house? No more pressure, no... Okay. Some of you looked at me like, what are you talking about? Yeah. Well, this is, we have our four sons, and 1 year we have all of them come for Christmas, but not Thanksgiving, and then another year we have all of them for Thanksgiving, and not for Christmas. And so we just had them all here for Thanksgiving, so we won't have them for Christmas. So Barb and I are trying to decide just exactly how we can best serve the Lord. And we've got some ideas, but you don't want to talk about that. I do want to talk to you about an amazing night. Something that we used to do on an amazing night was, I grew up in Arizona, up by Lake Powell. Have any of you ever seen that area of northern Arizona? It runs up in the, have any of you ever seen Manhattan, Kansas? Or, yeah, okay. No, I'm just kidding. But we would go up on the north edge. The city was built on a mesa. Sandstone, and then a very large flat area, and then it cascades down into the lake valley, and we would go in the evening and park our cars on the edge of that up there and tune the radio to KOMA in Oklahoma City. Do you remember that, Wolfman Jack? I'm really going to get to the word this morning, so don't freak. But the thing that was so amazing was there was really no ambient light in the desert in northern Arizona. And so the stars on the clear nights and the moon were just brilliant. And as the sun began to set, all of the colors in those cliffs changed colors. It was an amazing transformation, but visually it was an astounding kind of experience to have. And I left that town in the fall of 1975, and I still clearly remember seeing that the striking images, there were some guys just doing their thing, and they had an astounding image event that changed them forever. And so, let's see if I can, the power is on, the button is pushed, the other button is pushed, aha, so down is forward?
Down is, yeah.
Okay, thank you. The sermon is entitled An Exciting Night, and we're going to look at Luke chapter 2. I would like to assign you to read Luke chapter 1 if you have not already, because in it, the angel Gabriel does some amazing work, some traffic, some announcing, which is what he is. He is the announcer. But he shows up to Elizabeth, he shows up to Zechariah. Zechariah doesn't quite believe what he's hearing. And so he says, how can Zechariah, after Gabriel told him, the angel told him that his wife was going to have a child in her old age, he goes, we're both old. How can I know this is going to be true? And Gabriel, he's like, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. And because you haven't believed me, you're not going to be able to speak until all these things come about. And Elizabeth, also, she did not say anything like that. She just discovered that she was going to have a child, and that she said, God has taken away my shame in my old age. And then Gabriel goes down again, and he finds Mary, and he tells her, you're going to give birth to Messiah, to the Christ. And she asks questions. Her heart is different than Zechariah's, though, because she was not, she says, how can this be? Which is an honest question. And the angel says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and will overshadow you, and you will give birth to a son, and you will name him John. And so it's an amazing story there. But if we go on into Luke chapter 2, which is where, pardon me, I'm going to go on to, this, you know, exciting night. What are the kinds of things that you think are exciting? Do you have things that you love to do, you love to go to, you love to participate in, that you think are exciting? I just put up a few things here that are exciting to me. And I'll just show you real quick here. I think fireworks are exciting, especially if there's a mistake and they all go off at one time on the ground. That's pretty exciting. In addition to that, I have always been fascinated by flight. And I remember as a small child going to an air show with my mom and dad and seeing the Blue Angels. It was not in that particular aircraft, but it just astounded me. And the way they could fly those formations so closely and tightly and not make mistakes, and machines that weigh so much that are so agile in the air, it was just really exciting to me. And then I told you I grew up in Arizona. And this is a shot of the Grand Canyon. Now, we used to, when I was in junior high and high school, every Sunday after church, mom and dad would load us in the wagon Queen family truckster. Actually, it was an 81 Oldsmobile at that time, but we went to the Grand Canyon every Sunday afternoon. And certain things were traditions. And we almost always went to the North Rim. And I had a picture, but I didn't want to take the time to find it. But it's a picture of my mom at Bright Angel Point. And my dad and I and my sisters are standing there and we're looking down and it's just glorious. And my mom is behind us. And Dad says, come on, Louise, you know, you won't fall. I won't let you fall. I remember she got on her hands and knees and just kind of snuck up and peeked over the edge. And Dad said, just stay right there. And he clicked that picture at that time. But if you haven't seen that, it's an exciting thing. And so none of these are as exciting and have the far-reaching impact of this group of guys we're going to look at in Luke chapter 2. And so they're in the dark on a hillside, tending their sheep, and they hear the proclamation. And I've always wanted to be able to totally black out the sanctuary. I've never been in a church or pastored in one where it was possible without incredible effort, but totally black, totally dark, no street lights. Might have been stars, might have been moon, might have been, I don't know. I didn't look into all of that. But let me tell you what happened. I'm going to read from Luke chapter 2, beginning with verse 8. And you can just listen and imagine it, or you can look in Luke 2, beginning in verse 8. And after the birth of Jesus actually had taken place and all of the things that preceded that, it says there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. I love the way the King James says it. They were sore afraid. You remember hearing that? Yeah, and to be afraid to the point that it hurts, that's not what it meant, but it just meant very, very afraid. The angel in verse 10 said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Father God, this morning, as we unpack this, I pray that you will open our minds, our hearts, our understanding to receive what you want to say to us today in this church in Clay Center. I pray that you will move freely, that you will speak in a way that we are changed, transformed by the renewing of our minds. And we pray that you will, Lord, help us to be obedient to you as you move, in Christ's name. Amen. So what I just read to you was the proclamation out of Luke 2, 8 through 20. There are some things here I want to just challenge you with. It's not going to take a long time, but I want you to consider some things. The first thing is that the shepherds were out, and the word says, living in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. They were out there doing their thing. They were living their lives. And a lot of times, people think that when God moves, that it's going to be, oh, I'm going to have to move to Africa or China, and I'm going to have to uproot my entire life, my family, sell all my possessions. And you know what? Someday, sometimes, it might be that. I have a very good friend who is a physician, had 5 kids. God called him to help with indigenous clinics in China. And he literally sold everything and packed up his family and moved to Beijing and began training Chinese physicians on how to run local clinics. It was an extreme call and an extreme response. But we don't often think about the fact that God calls us where we are. He calls Danny down in his shop. He calls you in your place of work, in your family, in your home, to be obedient to him, to do your thing, but keep your mind and your heart open to what God is doing in your life. And so we see here that was their thing, pretty much, right there. What looks amazing about it? What looks extraordinary about it? They're just doing their thing, keeping watch over the flocks. And then Gabriel shows up. God interrupted again. Now, I say again because I told you about Luke chapter 1. When Zechariah is going in to the temple to take his turn in offering the sacrifices. And Mary is just doing what Mary's doing, wherever she is. And he interrupts. God sends Gabriel. And sometimes I would like to, I wonder how those conversations go. You know, how formal is God? How informal? How loving? How friendly? How does he do it, you know? Does he become, thou Gabriel, come forthwith, and truly shall I not send you to, you know, or does he go, hey Gabe, come here, I got a job for you. I don't care, it doesn't matter. But the fact is that God sent Gabriel again, and he interrupted the shepherds in the middle of what they were doing. And so, you imagine you're sitting in the dark, and suddenly the glory of the Lord shines around you. And they're not used to all of this artificial light and laser light shows and car headlights and all of this stuff. But when the glory of God shined on them, they were very much aware of it because it happened. He interrupted Zechariah and Elizabeth, Mary and Joseph, their whole family, and now he interrupts the shepherds, who were pretty much just minding their own business. And the Bible says they were terrified. They were sore afraid. And as he does, if you look through the word, most of the time where God shows up, he says, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. And that would have to be pretty soothing. He says, I'm coming to you with good news of great joy. Good news of great joy. Why? Well, because they had been looking for the coming of Messiah. And if you recall, if you study the intertestamental period, where not fully, but largely, God appears to be silent and not at work, he's showing up in a big way in this. And he says, don't be afraid. And then, in addition to Gabriel, who brought a little bit of light, which would have been a lot of light, then it says, a huge light show, an angel chorus. Now, interestingly, the word does not say the angels sang. It says, let me look at this exactly. A great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. So it is an amazing event. And as it continues, they are given instructions. They are given instructions. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger. And then the great multitude of the heavenly host appears. And then they're gone. The angels had left them and gone into heaven. I often wonder if did they watch them as they left? Did they just ascend up until they were out of sight? Were they like a flashlight or a spotlight and it just went pew and it was dark? I don't know. But it had to have been an amazing thing. And these guys that are out there watching the sheep, I wonder at their response. This is not in the scripture, but they're right here. Gabriel's right here, let's say. And he says, don't be afraid, I've got some great news. Unto you today is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And he goes on, and then suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angels saying, woo, glory to God in the highest. And it's like, and to those guys, they're standing there looking at that. And I wonder if they're like, you know, if they're overwhelmed. I wonder if it was warm and loving enough that they didn't really freak out too bad. But when the angels had left them and gone back into heaven, I wonder if they were just going, and they turn and they look at one another and they go, did you see that? I know me, I either would have not said anything, or I would have been amazing. I don't know. What would you have done? Do you know? I don't know how we can know for sure. But the angel, they're given instructions. And the instructions were correct. The word says that they went and they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. They are told where to go. And they were told, you will find. And they decide to do it. To go see for themselves. And that's in verse 15. In order for them to have seen it, after the angel Gabriel appeared, and after the multitude of the heavenly host appeared, the shepherds are faced with a bit of a dilemma. Are we going to go? Are we not going to go? Are we going to believe it? Are we not going to believe it, what we've just seen? Did we all see it? Was it mass hysteria? They made the right choice. And they went. And they found Jesus. And the word says, just one, that little image there for a moment. They found Jesus and they were changed. They were changed. So they hurried off, found Mary and Joseph and the baby. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And they must have told it fairly enthusiastically or believably, because in verse 18, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Amazing. Amazing. They were changed. They'd gone from just being guys out in the field watching sheep to messengers, to proclaiming what God had revealed to them. And people were amazed. Do you ever tell people what God has done for you? Does God ever do anything in you, for you? Are you open to what God wants to do in you? Well, Pastor Rob, I'm too old. Well, if you can extend your hand and put two fingers on your radial pulse, and it's going thump, 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 or whatever yours feels like, he's not done with you. Amen. He's not done with you. And it may be a ministry of prayer. It may be a word of encouragement. It can be anything. I don't know about herding sheep or not, but these shepherd guys are changed. And what has happened here is an example to us and for us that begs some questions. Are you willing to hear? I can't talk in front of people. It makes me too nervous. I'm too shy. I'm too reserved. I don't speak very well. It doesn't have to be that. It could be anything. The question is not, what are you going to do at first? The question is, here am I, Lord. Send me. Are you willing to hear what he has to say? If he were to draw your heart towards something, are you willing to do it? Additionally, if you hear the call, are you willing to go? Are you willing to obey? In John 14:21, the scripture says, Jesus talking to his followers, he says, whoever has my commands and obeys them is the one who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. And all through the middle of John there, toward the end, actually, again and again, God talks about, or Jesus talks about, obedience being an indicator of love for God. We can say we love God, but if we don't do what he asks us to do, and I'm not saying just, because activity does not necessarily equal accomplishment. But if you are living close, your ear is attuned to God, and he draws on your heart, never anything that is contrary to the scripture. Be aware of that. But just be willing to be obedient in all things. Are you willing to let God put your fear aside? Sometimes when God calls you to things, it's scary. Sometimes the way he calls or the way he talks is scary, and other times the thing he asks us to do is scary. But he's always there saying, do not be afraid. Like in John 14 at the beginning, you trust, you believe in God, believe also in me. Are you willing to be transformed? Are you willing to be changed into whatever God wants to make you? What if he asks you to do something you've never done before? He will not ask you to do something that he will not equip you to do it. In Philippians 1, he who began a good work in you will see it through to completion in the day of Christ Jesus. If he starts the work, he's going to continue. Are you willing to be changed? Are you willing to be made new every day? Are you willing to be excited? Are you willing to be transformed? Now notice here, these amazing things happened to these shepherds. And this is what happened to them after they told people in their travels. They went, they obeyed, they saw, they worshiped, and then they shared the message that had been given to them at that time. And then it says they returned. Return to what? To what they were doing before. The sheep had to be watched, had to be tended, had to be cared for. But there's a difference this time. The shepherds return, and now they're glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. God is faithful. God will always provide the means for you to do what he asks you to do. And so, Father God, today, as we've looked at this passage, we give you praise and thanks for the way you do things. It is amazing. And we, Lord, we want to be obedient. Help us rightly discern the times when you call on us, when you urge us to go about your business. Give us the courage to comply, and give us the ability to give you thanks and glorify your name because of all that you're doing. You are an awesome God, and we thank you for our Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Will you please stand as you're able, and we'll sing hymn number 278, words be on the screen.
Oh,
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the words that we've heard this morning. We thank you for using Rob to impart those to us. We ask that you be with us as we come through this next week, that you might use us for your service, and that we might be pleasing to you. For it's in Jesus' name. Amen.